So I want to take an opportunity to have you turn to Philippians chapter 3. And we're going to look at verses 12 through 16. Philippians chapter 3. I had Ephesians on my mind. Sounds like a song, doesn't it? Philippians chapter 3. And we're going to look at Paul in this study asking us to agree with him about something. And we're going to explore that something right after I pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this opportunity to come and to open your word and to open it, Lord, looking for what you have for us in it. Opening our hearts to what you say. Opening our spirits to what you want to do. Opening our minds that you might teach us. So we come, Lord, and ask through Holy Spirit ministry, we would know a fullness in you by living out your word. So I ask that you would minister to us, help us. We'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, Philippians chapter 3, and we're going to be looking in verse 12 and following. Follow along in your version of the scripture. Might be a little different than mine, but might we give attentiveness to the word of God. Paul proclaims in Philippians chapter 3, verse 12, "Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, let us, as many as are mature, have this mind. And if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us be of the same mind." Paul is asking us to agree with him, and he emphasizes it by saying, "This one thing I do." And there's a very real sense in which he is inviting each of us to be part of that one thing he does. Now, the first thing that I want us to look at is in verse 12 and verse 3, where he says that he has not and that we have not attained or apprehended yet. So when Paul tells us, "I want you to hold on to this one thing," the one thing that he is doing is remembering something. And the first thing is, we are not perfect yet. We are in the process, I trust, of maturing. And if you are not growing in your Christian life, and if you are stagnant in your Christian walk, something is wrong that needs to be ferreted out by ministry and attentiveness given to the Holy Spirit. Come to God's word or go among God's people that you trust. But if there is a lack of maturity, and if there is a stagnancy in your Christian walk, don't be satisfied with that. And even though Paul expresses to us that we aren't perfect, nor will we be perfect until that time that we fully attain, or fully apprehend, that is no excuse to live throughout this life with a mundane Christian experience, with a walk with Christ that is not developing, deepening, maturing. We've got to be sensitive to that. And Paul is saying, look, this is one thing I do. I remember that I'm not perfect, that I am progressing, that I haven't fully attained, and I haven't fully apprehended. I haven't, in a sense, arrived. As deep as you are in your walk with God, as deep as you are in your knowledge and in your cultivation of a relationship with the Holy Spirit, you and I are not perfect yet. You and I have not learned everything, done everything, seen everything there is to see and there is to do. So this first area where he wants us to agree with him that we ought to be doing this is reminding ourselves that we are not yet attained and apprehended. We are not perfect. In him we are complete, but we still have that development and that growth. The second thing I want you to see in this passage of scripture, in Paul saying, this is what I do, and I want you to do it too. He says, I forget those things which are behind. I forget those things which are behind. Look at verse 13. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. I know that you have heard. I know that you have had teaching on this. This is not rocket science. This is not all of a sudden something brand new. But there comes a point in time where we have to leave what was in what was. And if it has been repented of, and if it is confessed, and it is forgiven, then we need to get past it, beyond it, and look for what is ahead. One of the things, a number of years ago when I was preaching at youth camps, I came to this realization that A, I cannot obey God in the past. If I hadn't, I cannot obey God in the future because I'm not there yet. I can only obey God in the present. I can only live in the present. But if I will allow the behind me to deter what is going to get me where I want to go, I'm frustrating what God is doing in me in this now. In this moment, in this walk, we go from moment to moment, from walk to walk. And I want you to realize that when we come to this, it is imperative that you and I realize what is behind, what is past. Might have been wonderful, might have been good, or it might have been terrible. It might have been a story of failure. It might be a story of missing the point. Underneath the blood of Jesus Christ, that's gone. And even if it is the very best, it's still in the past. And God is at work in us now. And that now allows us to focus ahead to what he wants. We always need to be moving forward in our relationship with God. And we are to forget those things which are behind. And there can be thousands of good things, great things. But sometimes it is the hurts and the things that are bitter and the things that are defeats that seem to derail us. And though it is not wrong to go back and look at some of our victories and look at some of our strong areas, Christians ought not to be too much interested in waxing nostalgic. We always need to be ready for what is new and what is next. The next thing that he says is that he reaches forward to those things which are ahead. He reaches forward for those things that are ahead. Why am I being so emphatic? Because sometimes we may view the future like this instead of like this. Or we may look to the future or what's ahead like this. Instead, God tells us through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in the life of the Apostle Paul that this one thing he does, he realizes he isn't perfect, but he needs to grow and to develop. He needs to forget those things which are behind. But he is to open his arms and reach forward to what is ahead. And that is something Paul says he does, that he wants you and he wants me in our spiritual life to do. He just doesn't want us to embrace what's coming. He wants us to reach for it. He just doesn't want us to embrace it and say, oh, whatever. He wants us to go and say, yeah, that's what I want. Can we say that about spiritual things in our life? That's really crucial and really important. And then I look at the final thing. Excuse me again. He says this, that he is pressing towards a goal. Again, verse 14, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And then he talks about being mature and having that mind. And if you don't have that mind, that you're to let God reveal it to you. And that no matter what level of maturity, no matter what level of walk, he wants us to realize that there is that same simple rule in effect. I haven't arrived. I haven't been made perfect yet. I am complete in Christ. But I am waiting that day when I will be transformed and changed. And he says, don't forget that what is covered by the blood is covered by the blood. What is covered, what is atoned for, what was behind. And the other thing is, he asks us not to be satisfied with yesterday's victories, but instead to reach out and grasp and hold on to those victories that we'll have in the future. And he says, remember, we're always pressing towards a goal. And that goal is the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And whether we are a babe in Christ, or we are a mature saint in Christ, or whether we're somewhere in between, we are called to walk. We are called by this same rule that Paul's talking about, this one thing that he does, to press towards the mark, to go toward that perfection, to go spirit-led, spirit-filled, Bible-encouraged into what he has for us. In A.B. Simpson's song, Launch Out, which we don't sing much anymore in the Christian Missionary Alliance and probably doesn't get sung much anywhere else. In it, there is a verse that says, let us be lost in the mercy of God. Really, really important. Earlier in the song, he says, the mercy of God is like a deep, unfathomed sea. And we're called to launch out into the deep. There have been a couple contemporary songs that catch that same flavor. Walk out into the deepness of God's love. Walk out into the deepness of God's experience. Press towards a goal to be lost in the mercy of God. To be lost in the mercy of God. It's a goal. I could have said it'd be lost in the love of God. To be lost in the grace of God. To be lost in the fullness of God. But Simpson used it as this idea of being lost in the mercy of God. Because it is through that mercy that you and I see that even though we aren't perfect, though complete, and even though we sometimes resist and shy away from what's ahead, he nevertheless has for us a goal to launch out into the deep. I trust these areas for these moments will be helpful for us, that they will speak to your life and to my life, and that we'll come to this passage in Philippians chapter 3 and not just say, boy, that's a good lesson, but that we would embrace and that we would agree that this is what, like Paul asked us, to do. Now, I'll pray and ask this in Jesus' matchless name. Amen.